Now, today we're going to talk about that toxic mix of too much body fat and COVID-19. So a lot of people have seen it. There was a family in, New Jersey, 6 or 8 months ago. There was a family picture. They had a family gathering, and there was a lot of obvious overweight family members there, or there were a lot. And the rest of the story was right after that, there was a huge amount of death and disability in that family due to COVID. What is the issue with COVID and obesity? First of all, let's remember and let's think about the common issue. We used to think that body fat was an inert energy storage tissue. That was up until about 5-10 years ago. And now we realize that's not the case at all. Body fat is a very aggressive hormonal tissue. And that's what we're going to talk about today. It's that hormonal response that we get from body fat that causes this problem, as well as insulin resistance, as well as so many other things that we've talked about, which are to a large extent that common pathway for chronic diseases resulting in diabetes, prediabetes, heart attack, stroke, dementia, you name it. In the early days of the COVID-19 pandemic, doctors noticed something about people who became severely ill, that many were obese. Obesity may be one reason some countries or communities are hit hard. In the U.S., the obesity rate among adults has climbed for decades and is now at 42%. The rate's even higher among Black and Hispanic Americans. The data shows that even adults with a BMI of 30 to 35 usually will often face far worse outcomes from COVID-19. 5 times more likely to experience ICU admission compared to those that are not obese. And 2 times more likely to experience respiratory failure compared to those without obesity. Why is obesity a contributing factor? Well, scientists are still studying the factors. Excess weight increases the chance of developing several health problems, including heart disease and diabetes. Along with the obesity, heart disease and diabetes are among the conditions that increase a person's risk of severe COVID-19 illness. According to CDC. Here's an article out of Annals of Internal Medicine. Obesity and mortality among patients diagnosed with COVID-19 results from an integrated healthcare organization. Obesity itself increases the likelihood of serious complications. The way obesity affects the immune system may be one of the key factors. Sarah Tartoff, a Kaiser Permanente research scientist, speculated that large amounts of visceral fat play a role in severe COVID-19. Fat is not inert. It secretes chemicals that influence bodily systems. It affects the angiotensin system that helps regulate blood pressure and blood flow, leading to more severe symptoms. Although the exact mechanism is unclear, fat and COVID-19 share a common link in the upregulation of pro-inflammatory, prothrombotic, and vasoconstricted peptide hormones. Let me translate that. Body fat and COVID-19 both cause the immune system to be stimulated, and not stimulated in a good way. Stimulated in a way where we, the host, are taking friendly fire from our own immune system. Levels of anti-inflammatory adipokines, such as adiponectin in obesity, are associated with increased AT2, angiotensin 2. Again, let me translate that. It's the same as that first sentence. Body fat, COVID-19 cause some release of hormones, which cause inflammation. COVID-19 has been shown to cause that inflammation due to downregulation of inhibition. So again, you start getting into some logical complications there, but we're always in a balance. Our immune system is always in a balance. Some things push us to get more immune reactions. Some things push us to slow down that immune reaction. Things that are made by our body fat, as in adiponectin, cause us to increase that immune reaction. Things made by the COVID-19 reaction, cause us to stop. They break down the mechanism, which is usually tamping down that immune reaction. So you're getting a lethal combination resulting in a spiraling increase of this immune reaction. It's possible that COVID-19 is able to accelerate pathologic injuries from existing substrates like AT2 among people with severe obesity. Jennifer Leiter, NYU Langone hospital epidemiologist, said that people with obesity seem to have more ACE2 receptors. That's the gateway, if you remember, for the virus that spike protein links to. That could explain why men are doing worse and why prepubescent children are faring very well in the pandemic. ACE2 receptors. The virus infects cells by attaching to ACE2 receptors, and that receptor is abundant on fat cells. Another study found that the hormone leptin may make them more vulnerable to COVID-19. Now, that's a risk factor, again, assuming that it's true. When you look at the headline over to the right, obesity, the most common comorbidity in SARS-CoV-2, is leptin the link? That's what they're asking. You know, they're seeing increased levels of leptin, and they're going through some of the potential logic and biological mechanisms. Leptin regulates metabolism and appetite and is found in greater amounts in obese people. Obese people become what they call leptin resistant, similar to insulin resistance. High levels of leptin have been associated with a type of systemic inflammatory state. So here we see again, obesity and inflammation. Complications in care can arise once hospitalized. Fat can physically compress parts of the lungs, impeding respiration. So here we're talking about just a mechanical problem of ventilating. You know, it's like the old Pickwickian syndrome. You may have heard of it. It came from the book, James or somebody, remind me the author of that book, the English author, Pickwick syndrome. There was a fella in his book that was obese and he had trouble breathing because of that obesity. His name was Mr. Pickwick. To help with breathing, doctors have been putting hospitalized patients on their stomachs, but that can be difficult for the obese, making it more likely that they have to be put on a ventilator. Calculating medication doses, inserting intravenous tubes, getting good diagnostic images, and just moving patients around all become far more difficult when you're moving 150 pounds of fat along with a 100-pound or 150-pound patient, because the fat goes along with the patient, and now you're at, instead of 150, you're at 250 to 300 pounds of movement and dosing and imaging. For instance, standard doses for painkillers, blood thinners, and other critical medications usually stop at certain weights. What can be done? Aside from the steps to slow down the spread of COVID-19, CDC advises the following. Have a healthy diet. Good nutrition can support optimal immune function. Healthy diet can prevent or support self-management of heart disease, type 2 diabetes. Obviously, be active. Being active can help boost immune function, help prevent diseases, and increase a person's chances of having severe illness from COVID-19. Get enough sleep. Insufficient sleep has been linked to depression, as well as chronic diseases that may increase the risk of severe illness from COVID-19. You know, James has just gotten hooked up with a freestyle Libre, and he's been having a lot of discoveries. We're gonna give him a few minutes to share some of those over the next few YouTube Live events because of the importance of understanding our blood sugar. One of the things he and I were talking about yesterday afternoon was, I tend to have much lower blood sugar the nights that I'm sleeping really hard. Now, what does that mean? I don't think we know yet, but again, it underlines a couple of the unrecognized but very important items in terms of health, our level of blood sugar on a regular basis and our ability to sleep. One of the problems with lack of sleep is that our cortisol levels increase. And sure enough, if you don't get good sleep one night, you have increased insulin resistance for the next 48 hours. And yes, that does appear to be related to cortisol levels. Those of you who haven't read the book or heard of it, it's Why We Sleep by Matthew Walker. It's a very, very good book, entry-level discussion behind the science of sleep and its impact on health. Cope with stress. I knew an endocrinologist who specialized in diabetes once who felt like stress was actually the root cause of all diabetes. He felt like his perspective was, you know what, we live life, we get more and more stress on an hourly basis, 50, 60 years of it, and that ends up just resulting in insulin resistance, prediabetes. Stress during an infectious disease outbreak can sometimes cause changes in sleep or eating patterns, increased use of alcohol, tobacco, and worsening of chronic health problems.
continue to get great feedback regarding the webinars. And here's why. You know, on the internet, when you hear a webinar, you expect for somebody to try to sell you something. We're not doing that. We're trying to tell you something. People are coming in with their labs from Quest, inflammation panel, OGTT, insulin survey response, and then they're finding out, do I have inflammation? Do I have insulin resistance? And where does that fit in terms of other folks? We're getting ready to start one for CIMT as well. So again, people are really excited about finding out their own status. Looking forward to seeing you there. Thanks.